Thank you very much. Добро утро. Казвам се Горан Стефановски. My name is Горан Стефановски, and I have a great pleasure to be here this morning and talk to you. I was very impressed with the beginning of the conference yesterday. Very impressed with the hospitality of the Goethe Institute. As I'm impressed with the hospitality of the French Institute. What a grand occasion it is for all of you. Unfortunately, I won't be able to follow you in Gabrovci, but perhaps some other year. I am a practicing playwright and a screenwriter, and I'm up to here in my own current work. So I really consider myself your brother in arms, rather than a teacher. I suspect teachers. I am cursed with having to be one in England. I teach at Canterbury Christchurch University, and my website is full of the things that I've been doing in the last years. If you might be interested to have a look, but I am fascinated. I talk about screenwriting and scriptwriting all the time to people who even sometimes don't want to listen to it, and to be able to talk about that and have a little payment for that as well is an absolute bliss. So, but also talking to people who are equally excited about it is also very blissful. These are my mother and father. My mother was an actress, and my father was a theater director. And this is a picture from All My Sons, the Miller play, which they did in 1951, before I was born. One of the first memories I have of the theater was when I was five, I was taken to an opening night of a play, a melodrama, and at the end of the play, suddenly, somebody put out a gun and shot my mother. And the curtain came down, and there were applauses in the audience. But I freaked out. I didn't know what had happened. So my mother came backstage and said, it's okay, I'm alive. But I wasn't quite sure. And I'm still not quite sure she's dead, although she has been officially dead for 30 years. But I started thinking at that age of 5 years, what is fictional and what is real? What is backstage and what is front stage? And that fascination has kept me going for quite a few years. So obviously with that kind of psychodrama, you have to become a playwright. And here I am. So between 1974 and 1986, I was a very arrogant young man, and I started writing plays, and they all got performed, and they were very popular, and I started making money, and I got some prizes, and I really felt on top of the world. I really thought, ooh, I know how to do this. They told me that I had some little talent, and I said, yes, great. So I went on writing play after play after play after play. But then, in 1986, on the strength of my plays, the Faculty of Dramatic Arts in Skopje in Macedonia said, Goran, would you like to establish a scriptwriting department in Skopje? And I was stupid enough to say yes. I was arrogant enough to say yes. So suddenly, as it happened, there were 10 people looking at me, the playwright, and I didn't know what to tell them. I knew how it was done because I had done it, but how to talk to them rationally about that, I did not know. So that brought me to another level of fascination, thinking, what are we going to do? Is it teachable at all? Every time I go on planes, trains, and buses, and people ask me, what do you do for a living? I say, I teach playwriting. They said, ooh, pa to može li da se predava? Se prepodava. Why that suspicion about script writing? They teach music and nobody asked. They teach the arts, they teach acting, they teach architecture, they teach mathematics. All these very highly unteachable things, and nobody questions those. But script writing, they say, ne može to. For some reason, they teach languages. And there are all kinds of books of exercises for mathematics. When I was 5, I went to school, 5 po 5, 6 po 5, 7 po 5, 8 po 5. Nobody asks you, you don't quite understand, why do I have to learn? You just drill them and shut up, it's good for you. So mathematics exercises, yes, we know there are numbers, and when you multiply them, when you divide them, there are all kinds of exercises for dancers. These are your muscles, this is your movement, this is what you do. There are all kinds of exercises for sports. Točno se znaje kako se proba plivanje, ve? Ima da you have to start drilling certain things, and you don't ask questions. Your muscles have to learn certain tricks. There are all kinds of music exercises. My brother is a famous guitar player, and he's got his notes, he's got his guitar, and he practices all the time, hours and hours on end, because he's got his instrument, and he knows what his exercises are. He's got his fingers. When you come to playwriting exercises, I picked this up from the internet the other day, they show me a muscle. What good is this for me as a playwright, you know? What is the set of my exercises as a playwright, is my question, which I'm talking to students about, because they have to be useful exercises. What do you tell them to do? How do you exercise playwriting? The problem is, we don't know what the instrument of playwriting is. Now, when you have an engineer, he's got his toolbox. Točno se znaje električar koji će dojde sa šrafciger. What do you call that? He's got a screwdriver, he touches a couple of wires, and you know what is live and what is dead. Nema tuka zabuna. When your electrician comes, when your doctor comes, he takes the temperature of your body, he listens to your chest, and he knows where you are. When it comes to makeup artists, they have all of their toolboxes and all the thousands of little details. When it comes to musicians' instruments, this is an alto saxophone that Charlie Parker used to play, you know? You just practice your instrument to death. If you learn how to drive a car, you get in the car, this is the pedal, this is the clutch, that's what you have to learn. When it comes to sound recording, that's the table, you have to learn all of these little bits and pieces. When you come to camera, you learn your camera and you learn how the camera captures light, and that is your instrument. When it comes to editing, this is an analog editing table, you've got your table here and you've got to master the table. And I envy the people who teach editing and camera at my university. This is the Avid table, you press here, you get these parameters and all that. When it comes to artists, they've got their color palettes and all that. When it comes to playwriting, what's my tool? What do I exercise with? I asked this clever question yesterday, and I got very good answers about the meaning of the suffix W-R-I-G-H-T, and I understand that our colleague from Ireland quite cleverly decoded that. And we figured out that W-R-I-G-H-T is actually a very old English word, a medieval English word. That is, in nouns, worker, constructor, maker, builder, craftsman. So, right is not right. W-R-I-G-H-T has got nothing to do with the verb to write. There are very old English words like cartwright, wheelwright, shipwright, and plowwright. It is all about majstorive. Vo turskiot jazik, in the Turkish language, there is this suffix agia, bozagia, dogramagia, Не знам колко други. Митко, помогни ми. Кой други знаеш? Занаетчи. Сите се соаджия. Така да я много би сакал да постои некой збор драматаджия. Значи, майстор. Постои зборот в македонският театарджия. Имате ли вие театарджия? Меѓутоа, playwright is obviously a word which hasn't got much to do with writing at all. So, you don't really write scripts, you make them. But, Goran, if you're so clever, tell me, what do I make scripts with? And this is how I hit my students in my first 5 minutes. And I say, right, so what do you make them with? And they start improvising. Па, со идеи. Па идеи треба за се, не само за пишување на драми. Па со имагинација. Па имагинација треба за се. Па со слики. Абе, какви слики? Сакам да разберам за наетот кој е. Па со мисли. All kind of... Nothing gets close to the actual craft fiber, to the actual craft essence. I want, like a child in kindergarten, to understand what is my stuff that I can start making scripts with. It is extremely simple, really. I'm not going to ask you questions about it, but I'm going to just jump into it. The basic scripting ingredients, ladies and gentlemen, are contrasts, opposites, contradictions, or mismatches. Now, they tell me, the clever people in the IT business, they tell me that all of the internet, all of the MP3 files, all of Facebook, all of the JPEGs photographs, which I've got hundreds of thousands of on my computer, they are all reducible to what is the computer language reducible to? What is the essential bit of computing language? Zeros and ones. Excuse me, if zeros and ones are good for the internet, they're probably good for script writing as well. My batteries, I put some new batteries in this little thing, have a minus and a plus. Is that good enough for a battery? Yes, it is. The old primitive people would have two stones, flint, and they would just rub them against each other to produce what? To produce fire. I am interested in the basic ingredients that we as playwrights can rub against each other and produce a dramatic spark. And I guarantee you that if you find any contrast, any opposite, any contradiction, and any mismatch, if you give it to me, I'll give you a scene in 5 minutes. Why? Because I will work with the spark which is in the tension, in the contrast, in the opposite, and in the contradiction. There are billions upon billions upon billions of those, and you're going to rehearse them in a few short minutes for me. Let's have some illustrations. Is this a contrast? Is this a contrast? Is this one little contrast good enough for hundreds of short animated films? Machka, one cat and one mouse. Is this good enough for action, for movement, for dramatic situations? Yes. Why? Because they're always going to chase each other. Is this a contradiction? There is always this license to kill cool secret agent who is always chasing a guy who wants to destroy the world. All of the franchise of James Bond is based on this one simple binary opposite. One, zero, and one, one. If this is good enough for Hollywood, we should learn a few tricks. It's a simple battery operation. It's an obvious contrast here. Is this a mismatch? What's happening in this Charlie Chaplin little short clip? You've probably seen it. He's eating a boiled boot. The way he's eating it is full of manners, as if he was in a very good restaurant. He's very cool, calm, and collected. He's eating the shoelaces as if it was spaghetti, and it's all very mannered. Why is it funny to watch? Because you don't eat boots, and you certainly don't eat them with such good restaurant manners. That simple contrast and contradiction gives you the farce. Is this a contrast and a contradiction? Some stupid producers in Hollywood decided that they wanted to make a film about a man who is pregnant. And they say, who is going to be most funnily pregnant in Hollywood? And they said, Arnold Schwarzenegger. Oh, all right then. And there was a happy screenwriter who walked away with a fat check out of that meeting. All you need to do in Hollywood is put some snakes on a plane, and you've got a film. Is this a mismatch? Any kind of human that can fly, any kind of human that is a bat, any kind of human that's got all kinds of subhuman additions to it, any kind of monster, any kind of super creature, is already on the way to becoming a contrast, contradiction, and opposite. Is this a mismatch? Yes. Is this a mismatch? What's this priest doing in a transvestite bar, having a good time? Ladies and gentlemen, five young people came out of Cambridge 40 years ago and decided to call themselves the Monty Python Flying Circus. And they decided that whatever we're going to touch, we will turn on its head, we will turn into an opposite and a contradiction. And they made serious millions and they made serious career just by learning how to flip things over, how to look in oppositions and funny contrasts. There is a wonderful one-liner about fish out of water. I could teach Shakespeare characters like fish out of water, people out of hinges, doors out of hinges. Everybody's out of breath in Shakespeare. Something has happened which completely demolished their comfort zone. Wrong place, wrong time. That's a simple contrast that can really take you deep into scripting waters. Look at these four ladies, all ex-girlfriends of the same guy, and now they've got guns and they're trying to go after his ass. And it's wrong place and wrong time. Wrong place and wrong time, mate. This guy had a good time with some lady, but the man has arrived with an Uzi, with a shotgun. What are the chances that we would see this kind of situation if we watched any soap opera tonight on television? Give me any television, just turn on the TV. What are the chances that we're going to come across this kind of situation? Pretty high. Wrong place, wrong time. A very simple contrast and contradiction. And here is one of the greatest blockbusters in the last 40 years in Hollywood. All you need to do is put a shark on a Florida sea where innocent swimmers swim. It's very funny. You go into the cinema, you buy your popcorn, and you see a big poster of a shark. Yeah? And in the first 30 minutes, while you're eating your popcorn, what do you see? Nothing. People swimming. What is it which gives us that excitement? We know something that the swimmers don't. There is going to be a shark there. It's a very ugly entertainment. You go to the cinema and you see a film called Titanic. And what do you see in the first hour and a half? A love story on a ship. What is it that the lovers don't know? They don't know the name of the ship that they are on. And we do. We're just waiting for the contrast and the contradiction. We're waiting for the mismatch. We're waiting for the wrong place and wrong time. We're waiting for the fish out of water. Ladies and gentlemen, these are things that are very easy to drill, very easy to exercise. Wrong place and wrong time. I'm going to throw some words to you, and I want you to throw me back the opposites of those words. There are billions of these. Good. Death. Strong. Hate. This is kindergarten. I told you it would be peace. On. Very good. Left. In. Plus. Hell. Slow. Public. Justice. Natural. A lie. The opposite of lie is truth. Black. Right. Sad. Great. Active. Legal. Oh God, yes. Poor. Tall. Cowardly. Ill. Smart. Loud. Closed. Cold. Deep. Ugly, hard, etc., 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 ad infinitum. Give me any of these, but any of these, I will rub my fingers and know where I have to do a little bit of research and find the spark. If you wanted to reduce the world of your favorite film to a single binary opposition, it's a nice exercise. You would, for example, reduce the cool license to kill secret agents 007 versus a lunatic who wants to destroy the world. Now, I would like to introduce my favorite word, which is a trap. На български как се казва? A trap for me, a scripting trap for me, is any kind of contrast, any kind of contradiction, any kind of mismatch, any kind of these things we're talking about. I like that active idea of, aha, who is trapping who here? The witches are trapping Macbeth. The ghost is trapping Hamlet. Richard III is trapping all of his enemies. There is always a chase and a trap going on. Script writing for me is laying of script writing traps. Our session will try to present a script writing toolbox for recognition, for exercise, and for production of these traps, of these contrasts, of these contradictions. This is a mouse trap. There is a scene in Hamlet called Mouse Trap. This is Houdini trying to get out of his chain trap. These are traps for fish. Fishermen can talk all their lives about lele kako ja, lele tuka sova, ja fati vaka, onaka. That's what they do. They talk about the contrast with which they fooled the fish. That's what we do in screenwriting. That is what robbers do against the police and the police against the robbers. It's those contrasts and those contradictions. Who's going to be fast? Who's going to be there first? This is trapping through sights. This unfortunately reminds us of some recent political scenes that were mentioned only yesterday. This is a trap of sleep deprivation. I'm sure that there are some people who do lots of games here and who look like this at 2 o'clock in the morning. This is a trap of hunger. Is there anybody here who's really been hungry in their lives? Anybody? No, you're all very comfortable people. I think it would be very good exercise for screenwriters to go hungry for 3 days. Just to see what's going to happen to our body, to our mind, and to really get into an exciting position of, aha, so this is what it's like. This is a trap of pain. All hospitals work with people who are trapped with pain. All drama hurts. All tragic characters hurt. Has anybody stopped breathing in this room? When we were children, we would stop breathing for 30 seconds. Ай, кой повече може да издържи без въздух? And then you stop breathing, and then you go blue in the face. It's an interesting trap. Ah, I need to breathe. This is a trap of thirst. Have you ever been thirsty? This is a trap of being caught short. Кога нема каде, а умрен си. It's such a simple physiological problem. This is a trap of no air, which I just mentioned. Are there any people in this room who have any financial traps? Yes. Are there any people here who have romantic traps because they've been trapped by their heart to love the wrong person? How many people have trapped you? You go to a bar and somebody comes and gives you a few stupid lines. Hey, what's a girl like you doing in a place like this? They're trying to trap you. And you just say, shut up and get out of here. But some people trap you with much more intelligent things. And you think to yourself, what a fool I was. How could it happen to me? Why was I caught like that? This is a man who is trapped with the wrong clothes. Can you imagine going to a funeral wearing a bridal dress just because you didn't quite get the invitation right? You're suddenly in a completely different zone of operation. If I came to this presentation with high heels, you would have thought slightly different about, this is an interesting man, right? It's suddenly a totally different kind of trap. If you gave me a marker pen, I could do some kinds to my face. I could have a bullet hole here, or I could have a clown face. I could have some. Within seconds, you can turn me into an opposite, into a contrast, into a mismatch. And this is what screenwriters do. Trapped by love. Trapped with no freedom. Can you imagine losing your freedom? It's a serious trap, being in jail. How many prison break films have we seen? And this is, of course, the ultimate trap that we are all trapped in. We are going to kick the bucket, as the English say. Whatever you do, however you organize your life, whether you're rich or poor, we're going to get it in the neck. And that's the ultimate dramatic irony of our lives. And this is what literature is all about, is dealing with love and death. And is ultimate questions, first and last questions. So obviously, script writing traps are something which really, really excite me. I will be talking a little bit today. Well, obviously, I wrote a little book called A Little Book of Traps, which was originally written in Sweden when I taught at the Dramatic Institute there and where I developed this research project. So that's the English. And then it was published in Belgrade, Mala Knjiga Zamki. It was published in Skopje, Mala Knjiga na Stafici. Published in Slovakia as Mala Kniha na Strah. And would you believe, it was published in Beijing in Chinese. I can't tell you what the title in Chinese is. But, Mitko, I'm talking to you. Where is the Bulgarian version, bre? Anyway, we are working on it. So, in order to make our lives simple, we need to find what our notes are. What are the notes of script writing? I envy the musicians who only have 7 or 8 notes. Bam, 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 bam. That is what you drill. Whether it's jazz or folk, or whether it's atonal, that's what you're dealing with. Sedmo su noti, će ga naučime i će svršime rabot. Koji se našite noti? What are the divisions of these traps? Well, actually, there are only 6. Just very similar to the notes in drama. First of all, we'll be talking about the where. And those are the scripting traps of space, place, and location, which are crucial for the action. We'll be talking about the when, as traps of time and timing, or rhythm, or sequencing, or pace, or edit, crucial for the action. We'll be talking about traps of the who, Those are the physical settings, or the mental settings, or the social settings of the character. You don't have to write anything down, because we'll be going into these in detail. The why, traps of motivation, or drive, or desire of the character. The what, traps of movement, change, an event happening, or plot crucial for the action. And the how, traps of approach, or attitude, or vision, or genre, which are crucial for the action. Let's have a little, I want to show you a 5-minute little film. Simon, doj da mi pomogneš malo. A brilliant short little film, and your job will be to write down as many contrasts, contradictions, opposites, and mismatches that you can find in it. And then I will ask you to throw them back at me. Is that okay? I just want you to think, aha, this against that, this minus against that plus, this zero against that one. So, благодаря, Симон. The film is called Goodbye, Mr. Snuggles. Enjoy. Your job is to find contrasts, contradictions, and opposites in this short little film. Може ли пояк тон? Добро.
Аха. Дешево, бре.
Hello, hello!
Hello!
Good morning!
Morning!
Well, are you ready?
Certainly am. What a day, Fred.
Sting light. I think it'll clear.
Yes.
My dear fellow, look. Look at all the cuts in that tree. Well, all the trees. Autumn is just beginning, isn't it?
It's quite exquisite.
Let's go on. Our cook, you know, she really knows what she's about when it comes to food. Especially crumbles. Mind you, she does also make a superb Le Monde.
Thank you.
have.
Okay. Thank you, Father Simon. 30 seconds to recollect your thoughts and look at your notes of contrast, contradictions, and opposites, please. Okay. And I would like to ask you to tell me how many contrasts, opposites, and contradictions could you find in terms of the space, place, and location? Anybody? There are very serious contrasts and contradictions there.
One of the upper is in the open space, and the other one is in
very close. Very close, yeah. Is the open space very still?
Yeah.
And is the closed space very manic and claustrophobic? Very good. Any more? Contrast in the space. This is the basic one. Let's move to the time. The time and timing and the rhythm and the sequencing and the pace and the edit. Where are contrasts and contradictions here? The time of the approach of the two gentlemen is very slow, it's very measured, whereas the time and timing and sequencing of the lunatic clown is very hectic. It's a complete polarity in the dramatic quality of that dimension. Anything else?
At the end, well, just the timing or the calmness of
the painters.
The painters versus the action of shooting.
Yes. What about the who? Give me as many contrasts and contradictions in the characters and characterizations as you can think of. What are the physical settings? What are the physical settings first? Physically, what do they look like? The main two painter characters. What do they look like physically? What do they wear? They're tweedy, upper crust, aristocratic, gentle men, English. Cool, calm, and collected. Is that right? That's what they look like. They've got a straw hat. They've got. What does the clown look like physically? Well, he looks like a clown, first of all. He's got a garish face. He looks like a complete dangerous psychopath. So, obviously, mentally, the clown is hectic. And the guys are emotionally steady. And socially, very crucial contrast and contradiction, socially, these people are probably aristocratic, very high, middle class. And the clown is what, socially? Probably a playwright who's gone down on his luck or an actor. So, obviously, we are dealing with contrast, contradictions, and mismatches that have been very well established. Ones and zeros, minuses and pluses, all over the place. The why. What's the motivation? Well, we never question the motivation of a psychopathic killer. He just kills birds. You think, oh God, you don't ask those questions. But there is one very exciting trap in the film, and that is that this cool, calm, and collected gentleman actually handles a gun quite well. And you think to yourself, where did he find it? Where did he shoot? Is this the first time these two characters meet, or is there a backstory here? Have they met before? I have a feeling that this clown knows exactly where to find this man, and that showdown, which comes out of Spaghetti Western, is very much there. The what? What is the movement? What is the change? What is the event? What is the happening? What is the plot of this little film? I mean, the kindergarten word would be, what change is here? Two people go out in nature and suddenly they meet a psychopath and they kill him. It's a huge change. It's a huge minus and plus. It's a huge event, huge happening. And the how. What is the approach that the makers of this film have taken? Is this something sad? Is this funny? Is this sad and funny? Is this serious? Is this funny and serious? Is this tragic comic? What would you say? Is this bitter and sweet, like the Chinese sauce, a little bit? I would think so. It's a combination, a lethal combination of humor and seriousness. Right, well, let us go now into a little short elaboration of the setting of the where. As I said, the script writing traps are of place, space, and location. Now, you are screenwriters and playwrights. What needs to happen here and now for this room to turn into a dangerous zone? Physically, what should happen to the space? It's such a simple thing for students to invent a situation in which blood starts dripping from the ceiling. It's a very simple thing to shoot as a film. Or green vapor comes out of there. Suddenly we're in Oz. Do you know what I'm saying? This has turned into a totally different kind of space. I don't want to talk about snakes coming through. I don't want to talk. What about an earthquake? What about flood? What about fire? All of these things are contrast and contradictions. What about the ceiling collapsing on us? They are contrast, contradictions, and opposites of the place, space, and location. So if you have a quick look at examples of the where, disaster area, magic wonderland, off the beaten track, home, which has turned into a trap, all of the Pinter plays are about this. In the dragon's den, between a rock and a hard place, crime scene, do not cross. All you need to do is to take a little police tape, put it on those doors, and suddenly we're in a crime investigation scene. Polizia ne pominue. Point of no return, exile, stratosphere, dream, on the road, underworld, virtual reality, etc., etc., etc. People, of course, have counted the places in Shakespeare's plays. There isn't anywhere that Shakespeare hasn't been. In Antony and Cleopatra, there are 52 changes of place. He hops from one continent to another. And Samuel Beckett won the Nobel Prize on inventing a space that had never been seen in theater before. What is the space in which Waiting for Godot happens? The jokes which Estragon and Vladimir talk about are very simple. I mean, the language is very simple. It's just two Irish guys banter. But something happens to the time and to the space, which is completely revolutionary, which won him the Nobel Prize. He invented the space of nowhere for the first time ever. And he invented the time of stasis, ništo ne se slučuje ove, completely against Aristotelian idea of drama. Two people just sitting, hanging on in quiet desperation, where nothing happens twice, as they say. And that is pretty exciting way of dealing with space. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's get real here. If Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer came through those doors full of coffers of money, or if Coca-Cola Company came full of coffers of money and said, "You're all playwrights, we want you to tell us where to take our new Coca-Cola advertisement, give us the space and spaces," what are we going to do? It's hundreds of thousands of dollars waiting. You have to think on your feet, because the last advertisements of Coca-Cola were around the globe. What about if Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer came and said, "We need to know where the new James Bond is going to be set. He's been everywhere. He's been to the moon. He's been under the... Where would you take him?" And for many years, I was taunting and teasing my students. And I was always very arrogant and clever. I said, "We've never seen his home." But the bastards 2 years ago gave us Skylark. So I don't know how to tease them anymore. Can you think of a place and space and location that hasn't been used in Hollywood before? Well, we'll go to them. What I'm saying is that if you have an idea of space, place, or location, you're looking at your first million. There is always a new something that we've never thought about before. 10 years ago, two young kids of 25 gave us a film, a monster blockbuster, with space that had never been seen on cinema before. What space am I talking about? Which film am I talking about? And who are the guys who've been laughing all the way to the bank? I'm talking about a film called The Matrix, and I'm talking about two guys called the Wachowski brothers. They gave us the space of virtual reality, and good for them. Have you seen Inception? About six layers of a dream. Have you seen the head of John Malkovich being John Malkovich? Charlie Kaufman puts the action inside. You think to yourself, well done, Charlie Kaufman. You look at the 30-second advertisement, the spaces of music television, the spaces of video games, the spaces of 30-second advertisement, they're out of this world. The spaces of modern dance, the spaces of performance, it's amazing. I was lucky enough to see lots of Bob Wilson productions in my life. You think to yourself, man, take me there, wherever there is. Peter Brook, Midsummer Night's Dream. Whew. The space is incredible. La Page, the spaces are amazing. Complicité in London. The spaces, has anybody seen Street of Crocodiles? They are complete geniuses in working out. So let's have a look at, this is a trapped in stratosphere. We just saw some, the Martian and all this. This is a place where somebody is trapped in a desert. You have to start collecting. Put in your diary, put in your file in a computer, thousands and thousands and thousands of spaces. Just to remind yourselves of, aha, so these places have been taken. This has been done. Just start roaming down your television set and you will see. This is trapped in a fire, this is trapped in a box. And this is trapped in a door. And this is trapped in a boring room. Where are the dances of Pina Bausch taking place spatially? Well, one of them in Café Miller is happening in a café. trapped in a telephone box. Can you think of a Hollywood film about somebody who's trapped in a telephone box? Trapped in a photograph. Trapped under the sea. Trapped 6 feet under. Trapped in a war zone. Shakespeare knew a little bit about these traps. Trapped in ice. Trapped in the kitchen. Trapped in a yellow brick road. How many traps of space have we seen in Disney? He takes us places. Alice in Wonderland, you know? What is that space? Where are we? Well, we are an exciting new encyclopedia of possible spaces. Use these things and steal them. Your job is to steal, not to invent things. William Shakespeare wrote 37 plays. He stole all of the plots. He was too busy writing in order to waste time inventing things. Tarantino steals all of his plots. So don't try to invent new food. Try to learn how to cook with ingredients which are already there. Young people usually go into, I've got a writing block. Have you heard of a cook that's got a cooking block? You haven't. Why? Because cooks know that their job is to get the ingredients which are available. And those ingredients are always the same. It's always either meat or fruit or vegetables or pasta or dairy. Tiese se notite za kuvarot. Those are the cook's ingredients. Can you imagine a cook that is sitting in a kitchen trying to invent new food? Esther Blumenthal. Well, he's inventing new varieties of new recipes. Recipes are different from inventing ingredients. You can't invent meat. You can't invent water. And the thing is, you see, this is water. This is H2O, the oldest drink on earth. This is exactly the same drink which people used to drink 100,000 years ago. Do you ever get tired of it? Do you say sometimes, oh, it's such a cliche drinking water? It's such a stereotype. I want to drink something else. I want to find a new kind of drink because this is a bit... No, you just drink it, mate. Don't get stuck. Open the fridge and see what you've got in there. If you've got two eggs, put them in a little pan. Put a little oil there and let us eat. People want to eat food which has been tried and tested before. Of course with a little variation. Of course with a little spice. Of course with a little novelty in the presentation. Of course a new variation of spices and taste. That's why all these cooks are geniuses. You know, we know all about the French cuisine. But the ingredients have been given forever. So, learn from the cooks. Another thing which we have to remember is that we are all born with the instinct to eat. The first thing you do when you come out of your mother's womb is just, давай. So, we are all very comfortable and very... people who we have all eaten caviar, we have all drunk champagne. We are all very comfortable in our. You're all sitting here as if in a restaurant, and you're waiting for me to feed you. And it's a very comfortable position. Epa ovo znae, ovo ne znae. Ovo poslednji film na David Lynch ne baš. Bergman pa dobre, ama poveće go sakam. Our critical minds are monstrous. Our critical minds know within a second whether there is too much salt or too much sugar in the food. When the cook comes and gives us something, we are sitting here and say, "Ama malku solenko je." In order to get the salt right, you need hundreds of hours of cooking. You need, now, cooking is not comfortable. Cooking is going to the kitchen. And in the kitchen, you don't sit down. In the kitchen, you are sweaty. In the kitchen, you have to fight for your life because there is a 15 seconds difference between a triumph and a disaster. Like this. Cooking is of the hands. It has to be learned. It is not instinctive. Eating is instinctive. Cooking is hard graft. Cooking is exercises. So welcome to the kitchen, ladies and gentlemen. As of this afternoon, you're going to Gabrovtsi to do some cooking exercises, I believe. We only have another few minutes before our break. This is Trapped in the Tube. Being trapped in hell, trapped in prison, being trapped in a hospital. What an ugly situation. Like this, you sleep on a banana skin and suddenly everything has changed. Trapped in a flood, trapped in the matrix. This is the Warshawski brothers I mentioned. Trapped in the head of John Malkovich. Trapped in a haunted place of Elsinore. Can you imagine the ghost of your dead father coming and saying, hey, your uncle is sleeping with your mother. What are you going to do about that? Do you know what trap that is? That is the ultimate trap. Three witches are waiting for this man called Macbeth and say, this cocky general is going to come. We're going to get him mad. Othello is trapped by Iago. Richard III, ladies and gentlemen, Richard III comes on the stage and he's got a soliloquy. He's looking at us in the audience and he says, I am an evil bastard. I'm mean, I'm bad, and I'm going to kill everyone who comes near me. What do we do in the audience? We say, yeah, do it, man. Just don't touch us. We are making a pact with the devil. It's the devil incarnate who comes and says, I'm going to wreak havoc. Have you seen, what's it called, the American president, Kevin Spacey series, talking to camera and saying, all these idiots have made me the president of the United States. Trapped in a dream or a nightmare. Just say yourself, my scene is going to happen in a nightmare. My scene is going to happen in a labyrinth. My scene is going to happen where? Thousands of possibilities. Drill them. Exercise them. My scene is in a room. My scene is in a room which is in a labyrinth. My scene is in a place that's never been seen before. Trapped in the nowhere. Do you remember the Beckett play Happy Days? There is this woman who is up to here in the ground. Her soliloquy is not particularly interesting. It's an old housewife. It's talking heads of an old woman who doesn't know what to do with her life, whether to shoot herself or to make herself up in the morning. What makes the play a genius piece of art is that she's not really here. She is not of this world. In the second part of that play, she's up to here. It's the genius treatment of space which makes that play so special. It's another short play by Beckett called Play, in which there are three people up to here in urns. The kind of talk which they have is like the talk in Turska Sapunska opera. It's all who made love to whom. It's completely uninteresting. But what makes the novelty of the material is the treatment of space. So one of the exercises to do is, what is the where of your favorite film? Can you think of a where which hasn't been used on film before? Where hasn't James Bond been before? I mentioned these things. So, any volunteers, what is your favorite space in the theater? We know the dachas of Chekhov. We know the haunted rooms of Pinter. We know the hundreds of different places of Shakespeare. What about, give me one space in of latest film you've seen which impressed you. Anybody?
It's not the latest film, but the Purple Rose of Cairo.
Purple Rose of Cairo is jumping between reality and fiction. Jumping inside the screen. What a lovely visual presentation of a difficult idea. When I teach screenwriting to people who make short films in Canterbury, I usually talk about visual storytelling, ladies and gentlemen. That is why sometimes just forget words. It's the visual presentation. You can work in Hollywood all your life without writing one word. You can just draw storyboards for your films. If you work in Disney, you just storyboard, you draw your drama, you draw your scripts. Are we going to make a little pause now or in a few more minutes? Because it's now 12:15. What do you suggest, boss? What is ready? The ice cream? Okay, 3 minutes. Any immediate questions here? Think of traps, and you've got your friend. Script writing traps are very, very friendly to do your exercises. Look at a piece, look at a performance piece, see how they treat space. Steal it. Work around it. Obviously, what space does in video games is ever so exciting. And modern video games actually give us possibilities of Fallout 4, for example. Does anybody know Fallout 4, the video game here? When you go into a video game, you can choose different settings of the character. You can choose different space positions. You can choose the speed and time and timing. You can choose the genre. You can choose whether it's going to be a funny video game or a sad one. Video games these days are written by studios in which there are 50 playwrights working. And when they produce it, there are 500 hours of content. And I'm pretty sure that if William Shakespeare was alive today, he would be heading one of these complex script writing affairs. Any quick notes before we split for ice cream? Contrast, contradictions, and opposites, minuses and pluses, mismatches. Give me a mismatch. What is the main mismatch of time in Hollywood and in drama in general? What is the main ingredient of time? How do you deal with time? One word, and you understand what you have to do. One word is deadline. What is stress? Stress is fighting for time. All of James Bond is trying to defuse the bomb before it goes off. Countdown. If you learn countdown, you can work in Hollywood all your life without knowing anything else about screenwriting. Let the clock tick. You've got drama. The simplest possible trick on earth. Like a metronome in music. Change the rhythm. Thank you very much. I will see you in half an hour. Enjoy. Welcome back. Hi. thank you for staying for the second part. I would like to mention three things. One is I would like to say thank you to the poor translator in the back there. And I hope that... I hope that I'm not too irregular or too quick in my talk. The other one is to say hello to Vasco Shutarov. I don't know whether he is still here. Is he still here? No. Anyway, he was here for the first part. He is a counselor from the Macedonian Information Center here in Sofia, which is very nice. And last but not least, I would like to say hello to this young lady sitting in the front row. What was your name?
Rusina.
Rusina came to Canterbury, where I teach, with her mother. When was this? 3 months ago? She was choosing which university to go to in England, and she came to an open day. And I talked to her and said, look, I'm coming to Sofia in the summer. So here I am. So welcome, Rusina. I would like to go on now with the second level of operation, with the second setting, with the second note, if you want to call it, with the second database of inexhaustible settings under the when. The when is the whole world of the scripting traps of time and timing or edit or rhythm or pace. Let me just give you a few examples. I've got a few hundreds, a few thousands of these. I'm a big fan and collector of these. One is a deadline. I mentioned how terribly important that is. The other is, of course, back to the future. Deja vu. Dystopian time of end of the world. Circularity as time. Rewind time going backwards. Once upon a time. Ladies and gentlemen, if you wrote a play which starts with once upon a time, I get hypnotized like a child. You put me under a special operation. It's just like giving me an injection of heroin. I think, oh, I like it already. Once upon a time, off you go. Whatever scene you write, multiply it, exercise it against these possibilities. Synchronicity, time warp. Time warp is such an exciting thing that David Lynch always plays with. Suddenly time is not of this. Time warp in performance, time warp in dance, time warp in television, music, television, videos, real time, dream time, freeze frame, slow motion, or speed it up time. I think that Waiting for Godot is a bipolar play. Half of it is static and depressive and catatonic. Half of it is completely manic. These guys don't know what to do with themselves. If you get that timing right, you've got the balancing act of the piece. Linear time, of course, television. Old people who watch television want the linear time. Prvo to se sluči, pa potom to se sluči. Fragmentary time. I love fragmentary dramaturgy. I love countdown. Now, what is the worst time of year when you're going to get dumped by your lover? You can get, I mean, it's bad enough that your lover dumps you on any day. But give me something which is specially difficult, a special contradiction. St. Valentine's Day. That's brilliant. St. Valentine's. Why did Christmas, anniversary, birthday? Do you know what I'm saying? You find the deepest, sharpest dramatic trap. So, music videos and radical experimental films or radical experimental performances use time which is abused, fractured, or it goes at a frenetic pace. When I see a film by Tarkovsky, I see that flow of very special time zone. Don't hurry, Goran, we are going deep. And that's not Hollywood time. If you speed it up, it absolutely loses its meaning. It's elongated time. It's elliptical. The time of Fellini, the time of Antonioni. They are made in the way in which they handle time. That is what the dramaturgy is all about. Music videos give us a kind of gymnastics for the eyes, a roller coaster experience, hard to read attacks of short frames and images, noisy editing, examples of dense, opaque, and chaotic time. And modern dance very often does that, and certainly hip-hop does that, and certainly you go to a discotheque and they're going to blitz you with a kind of timing which is out of this world. You go in a different operation zone. Let's have a quick look. Deadline. Guys, if you learn one thing, put deadline on your priority list. You will never go hungry. Deadlines is like having eggs in the fridge. It's always there. It's always usable. It's interesting how students completely forget these things. You know, they give me a scene in which there is no focus space, there is no focus time, there is no focus characters, and I think to myself, kill me now. Time bomb, diffusing a time bomb. Time flies. Well, make it fly. A countdown, always a good friend. Past, present, and future. Try your scene in the past. Try it in the future. See what happens. The same scene is completely new. It's like frying versus boiling. It's like flambeing versus I don't know what other cooking to you. Seasons. The season of winter is rather different from the season of summer. At the beginning of Hamlet, there is fog. There are some guards on the battlements of Elsinore, and one of them says, "'Tis bitter cold, and I'm sick at heart." It's a guard who only has one line in the play. We never see him again. "'Tis bitter cold, and I'm sick at heart." Guys, this is a Hamlet kind of line. It gives us a complete entrance into the world of the play. Guards who cannot recognize each other in the dark. Who is there? Stop. Who is there? No, you say. Paranoia, war, danger zone. In the first line. Do you remember how Mozart's Don Giovanni opens? Brilliant space and time. Night, 2 o'clock in the morning. A chateau, a mansion. The windows open and a half-naked guy, Don Giovanni, jumps out of the room where he spent the night, or is spending the night with the lady. And the lady is shattered. She's crying after him, "Come back, you bastard, and finish off the job." In the meantime, the father of the lady says, "Who are you?" And Don Giovanni kills him. In the first 3 minutes, you've got a complete trap of a situation. Lovers, death, the whole range of themes are introduced. Rite of passage. Do you understand the word rite of passage? Special times. What is the time of Citizen Kane? It's a film which is 2.5 hours long, but it's actually a split-second film, is it not? Because at the end of the film, we are actually witnessing the moment of death of one person who's been looking at the whole of his life through the film. Fairy tale time, very special Disneyland time, ladies and gentlemen. Multiply your scenes by these. These are like spices, you know? Phases. Edit, flow, subjective time. Time just stops. If I was a director, I would make a production of Hamlet in which there is lots of subjective time. And I'm sure that Peter Brook would do the same, and I'm sure that you should just go in a different operation. Why hurry? It's Hamlet's play. Did you say you, sorry, I can't remember your name, you deal with invalids, do you? With people who are, I mean, I would love to make a production of Hamlet who's got a problem with his hearing or with his sight, with his eyesight. Oh, so it's you, Ophelia. I wrote a variation of Odysseus in which there is a scene in which he loses a tooth. Can you imagine what happens in the mind of a hero who suddenly sees that Що е ова, бе? Що ми се случва мене? Can you imagine James Bond in which he hasn't managed to sleep with the lady and is looking at himself in the mirror for the first time saying, who the F am I? Suddenly you've got a complete contrast and a contradiction. Of course, it wouldn't be terribly exciting for Hollywood, but it would be very exciting for me. The first line of Metamorphosis by Kafka is, Gregor Samsa woke up one morning and he was turned into a giant cockroach. Hey! Or one morning without any reason, Josef K. was arrested. A trap. Split screen, ladies and gentlemen. Use them. Use them in your short films and use it in your performances. And use it in Hamlet, of course. Rewind and reverse. Have you seen any films in which rewind and reverse is the main machine and the main engine of the film? Of course you have. What's it called? What is that film in which everything goes backwards?
Memento.
Memento, thank you very much. Did Harold Pinter write a play in which everything goes backwards? Yes, it did. It's called Betrayal. Slowed down time. Don't I just love this? Remember these positions and possibilities and play with them. They're yours for the taking. A time lapse. Jump cuts in film. Beautiful. Time tweaks. These are the jump cuts. Freeze frames. I love them in the theater. Time warp, which I mentioned. Phases. What a liberating concept it would be if you just gave yourself a title, which is called Phases. If it was called Unseen Footage of Hamlet. Hamlet's Secret Diary. What's Hamlet doing when he's not seen? Of course, Tom Stoppard, who was my guest in Macedonia a few months ago, did that with Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. There are lots of photographs with Stoppard, and I wrote a speech about him, which is also online. What is the when of your favorite film? That's an exercise question. Make a script around a deadline. That's the simplest thing to do in 5 minutes. If I had the time in the world, I would do it with you. Find an action and slow it down. Or speed it up. Or give it a time warp and see what happens to it. It's the same food, the same ingredient, which is cooked under different regime. Don't try to find unseen ingredients. Stick to the ingredients you know. Do you know what William Shakespeare did? He took a play by Thomas Kidd, which has now been lost. Do you know what the play was called? Hamlet. All he did was write his name on top. William Shakespeare, Hamlet. What is stopping you, Mitko Uzunov, to write Mitko Uzunov, Hamlet? And then you start cooking. Who had that strength of character as a playwright? Bertolt Brecht. Who in Germany did the same? Heiner Müller. Hamlet Maschine. It's the same material, you just tweak it. We are into the world of narratives, ladies and gentlemen. We are spinning narratives. Narratives are very few, and we're just tweaking them and reimagining them. Right, let us now go into the wilderness of the who. All of these photographs which you see were invented in the last 60 years. These characters didn't exist. Disney invented them. Can you think, this is the million-dollar question, can you think of an animal that Disney hasn't used yet? That is your $1 million. Do you know who invented animals that Disney had neglected? The people who made ants, the people who made Bugs Life, Pixar. They found some unused, little used animals. They made their empire there. the same people who made Toy Story. Can you think of an animal that's been neglected? Platypus. I haven't seen a film about platypus. I mean, last year, 2 years ago, they invented panda. You know, panda, we'd never seen a film about panda. So they said, right, we're going to have a panda. We know that panda is a very lazy animal. And they said, let's have a mismatch. What's it going to be? It's going to be a kung fu panda. I mean, it's a concept that sits in the palm of your hand. And it's Kung Fu Panda 2, and it's Kung Fu Panda Bloody 3. My son grew up on short films by four characters. They were all green. They were turtles. And not only that they were green turtles, they were ninjas. Not only that they were ninjas, but they also grew up in some kind of nuclear waste reactor. So they're what are they called? And they have Michelangelo. You think to yourself, somebody was on drugs when they were working on this. And that's all it takes, you know? It's just a little bit of flexing of your muscle. Anyway, physical character. Ladies and gentlemen, everyone who wears a mask is a contrast and a contradiction. Dressed to Kill, tall, dark, and handsome stranger, a superhero, devil in disguise, Scarface, behind the painted smile. But dress your characters up and down. Add character traits with a marker pen, rings around eyes, painted smile, painted frown, spots, tattoos, makeup. Instant makeover. This is a little software with which you can change person's faces. Very exciting for playwrights. Change your character by adding hairstyle, makeup, headgear, jewelry, clothes, shoes. Is Hamlet bald? Is he wearing a wig? Is he vain? Is he lame? This is wearing a mask. Wearing a uniform. Attractive, yes. A superhero. If I was in an exercise mode with you, I would ask you to give me a superhero in 5 minutes. To invent me one. That's what they do. A monster. Invent me a monster. An animated character. So that's the physical side of the character, that you can have endless variations of exercises with. But of course, we go now to the mental side of the character, and these are some mental who examples. A damsel in distress, a mad professor, don't look at me, Trigger happy, cool, calm, and collected, a femme fatale, a bag of nerves, a wild child, fearless, greedy, hesitant, jealous, happy, paranoid. Have a list of these guys, and next time you've got to solve a character, go and exercise it against a ready-made little toolbox list. It does help. Fearful. In love. Angry. Happy. Mad. Wonderful cliches and stereotypes, this. Good, bad, and the ugly. And we come to the last one, which is the social parts of the character. The social who. Whether your character is an upper crust, or black sheep of the family, or he's got problems with his peers, like in all of the Italian mafia films, or he's a breadwinner, or he's a professional occupation. Find an occupation, and you've got a character. People are what they do. My students want to have characters that have none of these qualities. Što raboti? Abe što raboti? Da li kole goveda? Ili a chirurg, what does he do? Yeah, but I wouldn't like to take any choices. Well, okay, but that's a Beckett play then. You know, you can't only, when you exercise, when you learn the craft, you've got to try all kinds of possibilities. Learning the craft is not so that you can only play against one kind of music. You take different notes for all kinds of different composing exercises. What is the political affiliation of your character? Is he a Muslim? Is he a Jew? Is he a Christian? Is he a Catholic Christian? Or is he an Orthodox Christian? Suddenly, traps appear, cracks appear, contrast and contradiction and dramatic sparks fly. Put two different animals in a cage and see what happens. A Muslim and a Catholic sit in the same plane going over to New York. Watch it for 8 hours for entertainment. Being a husband is a trap after 40 years. I love my wife to bits, but it's been 40 years. An estranged sibling serving the country. These are all social positions of the character. Politics, a serious trap. The moment you choose the political side of a character, you've got a scripting setting. Class, religion. All of these things can be chosen visually. They don't have to talk about these things. Peers, I'm going to show you. Peer pressure. Occupations, millions of them. Go into the yellow pages, ladies and gentlemen, and see how many billions of possibilities you can find in terms of occupations. Race. Is Hamlet black? Well, certainly in Peter Brook's production in Boof the North, he was. Family. All of Greek drama circles around this. Who slept with whom and why? Was I sleeping with my mother? Did I kill my father? I mean, frightening questions. And all of Greek drama circles around these simple parameters of who are my parents? Did they love me? Do I know them? Huge problems. So the simple question to ask every time you look at a scene you're trying to write, what are the physical, what are the mental, and what are the social characteristics? And try to exercise them, change them, draw them. Create fish out of water character. Can you think of a fish out of water character that comes out through this? The door opens. Let's imagine that the door opens. Who comes in? Who is completely out of this water here? Can you give me an example?
A terrorist.
Who else? Some students of mine wrote a scene about Vampires Anonymous. 8 vampires are trying not to drink blood anymore. And they're trying to find mental strength not to drink blood. And at one point, at the end of the scene, the door opens and there is a woman who says, "Excuse me, is this a transfusion place? I want to give blood." And that's the scene. Who used this? I mean, you remember the sharks who don't want to, that's in Finding Nemo. What animal hasn't been used by Disney yet? The why. This is, of course, the mental side of the character. The scripting traps of motivation, the reason, the drive, the desire. Ladies and gentlemen, I can't tell you how often students forget to put fuel in their car. The speed of your car will be in direct link with how much fuel you've got in. Your character will ultimately, sooner or later, depend on the relationship of his reason and desire. Abe sakam da ga ubijam. Sakam da se osvetam. Abe ja sakam ta žena. Ke odam preku svet. Abe sin mi mi ga ukradoa. My son has been stolen by fishermen. His name is Nemo. I am going to swim across the Atlantic. That is how strong my drive is. Check the desire. Check what's inside the soul of the character. You've got the thing burning. You've got the thing on fire. It's such a simple parameter. All of these self-esteems and breathing and food and water, physiological, and all of these you can find very easily. So the why examples, I did that in cold blood. Why I did it? Because of emotional blackmail. I did it for the hell of it, the jabebe or the inayet. I did it because of bad blood. I did it for a wager. I cut off my nose to spite my face. I did it out of pity. I did it to earn a living. I did it for revenge. It was an eye for an eye. I did it because I was facing my own demons. I did it as a labor of love. Write down your own list of 150 of these, and next time you get stuck for a motivation, go down the list and say, avatar. Negative motivations, gluttony, anger, greed, I love this, sloth, envy, pride, lust. You can't go wrong, choose one of these. These are the positive motivations, amusement and love and serenity and joy, and my wife who is green and wants to change the planet, and no one is good enough, including me. И постоянно се караме, а ти отвориме сардини конзерва. And my problem is, she thinks that should be washed in warm water and recycled. And I think like this. Well, first of all, I'm a bastard who wants to throw things in the rubbish. But I also think, by the time I've washed it, I'm using water and I'm using liquid. I'm messing up the atmosphere already. And there is always a danger that I will cut my finger on the bloody metal. So is that tension there? Very exciting. Pride, gratitude, awe, hope, in cold blood. We just love psychopathic murderers, guys. How many films have you seen in which you just don't ask questions? No Country for Old Men. The whole film of No Country for Old Men, there is a sheriff who's been trying to be good all his life. And he's watching this psychopathic murderer, and he doesn't understand, who is this man? What makes him tick? For 2 hours you watch violent murder. And this guy is saying, this is not a country that I belong to anymore. I should retire. Revenge of the creature. Revenge works like crazy. Always does. People love to watch revenge drama. It's a cliche, it's a stereotype, but so is this. Don't despise the cliches and the stereotypes intellectually, please. Try to dance with them. Try to be stronger than them. Don't despise them. Because it's like going thirsty without water. If you start saying, ne ove to, a ne, sakam nešto po, što sakaš biti? Ako Shakespeare ne se sramil od klišeto, ako Brecht ne se sramil od klišeto, i ako Beckett ne se sramil od klišeto, во драмите на Бекет имате клише колку сакате. Happy Days is about a woman who is going through a cliche, како се вика тоа, crisis. Estragon и Vladimir are piling up cliches. What's making that brilliantly new is that the cliche is undercut by the time and the space. That is where the novelty is. And that is where the genius, contrast, contradiction and opposite lies. Sacrifice, very strong. The why exercises, as I mentioned, what is the motivation of the character in your favorite film? Of course, there are lots of the tragic characters in Shakespeare are people with conflicting motivations. Ne zna da li da levo ili desno. All of Shakespeare's characters are completely split inside their hearts. This is a little scriptwriting equation. I hate formulas and I hate equations, but this is a rather useful one. They say that a character plus desire is a goal. Put some desire in the heart of your character and you've got the character's goal. And then put a barrier, put a hurdle to that girl. Не може ти това, бе. Ама како? Не може. You've got a conflict. And you've got a story. This is kindergarten stuff. Ама аз я сакам. Абе, ти я сакаш, ама не те сака она тебе. Ето ти приказна. За цел живот. Соня, кай си сега? Имав една Соня, шо я сакав, кога имав 14 години. Уште не ми е разрешен проблемът. Абе, вам ви е смешно, ама я да си казвам. The what? Значи, най-битната работа е кога, when you've chosen, when you look at a property of time, or space, or character, just ask yourself the question, always, how crucial is my choice of time for the action? How crucial is my choice of space for the action? How crucial is my choice of emotional, physical, or social character for the action? That is our question. How crucial? If it's not crucial, why is it there? Right, so under the what, we're actually looking at the overall structure, the overall trap of action. We're looking at the changes, we're looking at the movements, we're looking at the events, we're looking at the happenings, we're looking at the situation. Ајбе во една реченица кажи ми за што станува збор овде бе? Ама тоа е така една сложена... Не. One thing leads to another. A stranger comes to town. Kiss, kiss, bang, bang. Ете ти ви е формулата холивудска. Зашто е? Kiss, kiss, bang, bang. Тоа е. Целиот филм ноа, ти е тоа. Има една жена која заведува некого и го убива мажот. Accidents waiting to happen. Working against the clock. Biting the bullet. Opening a can of worms. Turning of the tables. A pursuit of happiness. Making a pact with the devil. Being a fish out of water. I can go on and on and on with these because I've got them written down here. The what is also known as story. A quick look at the thesaurus reveals the definition of story as account, with synonyms like adventure, anecdote, biography, chronicle, epic, fable, fairy tale, history, legend, memoir, myth, narrative, yarn, chain of events. Another generic term for the what is a plot. Do you remember what Aristotle said that the plot is? Plot is one action which leads to another action. Нешто кое предизвикува нешто друго да се случи. Гениално. Значи, не нешто кое нема последица, туку нешто кое треба друго. Значи, Митко го зеде автомобилот на таткото. Тука нема акција, тука нема драма. Меѓутоа, Митко го зеде автомобилот на таткото, таткото му рече, ако го земеш автомобилот, ќе те убија. Тоа е плот. Any contrast, opposite and contradiction can be seen as a nucleus for a story or plot or action. Any contrast and opposite and contradiction is a little spark. Action is the very structural fiber of your script. It is the through line. It's the backbone. Кога ќе видите бебе на 4 недели на... When you see a little baby unborn on a computer, what are the two things which mean life? It's a mess. It doesn't look like anything. But there are two things that you can, that a doctor can see, which says, aha, this is a baby. You see, what are the main things? There is a binary opposite there. You can see the backbone, and you can see the heart. And that's enough for life. The simplest synonym for action is a change, something which takes place between point A and B. And here are some standard examples of change: rags to riches, life to death, danger to safety, slavery to freedom, war to peace, and all that. Here is rags to riches, pact with the devil. Kiss, kiss, bang, bang. Kick ass. What's the plot of your film? Well, it's a kick-ass film. I know exactly what it is. Revenge is sweet. A love story. Strange tales. A funny story. A honey trap. A twist of fate. A contra. This is my favorite word, ladies and gentlemen. Contra, bre, obratnost. Imali bo bulgarski jezik zbor od obratnost? Se je obratno v dramata. What's the naopaku. Ete, to je. Eden zbor, ako treba da kažem što je drama, ja bih rekao naopaku. Naopaki. To je drama. Se je obratno. Ništo ne je kako što mislim je da je. I'm sorry that I'm slipping into a different language. How many people don't understand Bulgarian here? Quite a few, I suppose. Okay, sorry about that. I'll stick to English. Plot and plotting. God, did I waste time trying to figure out these Aristotelian. Everybody, when I went to drama school, they all talked to us about recipes of cooking. Nobody told us about the ingredients, which is what I'm trying to do here. Znači, prvo će imate, first you have the beginning and then the middle and the, what does that mean to me, you know? What is it that I'm working with? Rags to riches, hero to zero, innocence to experience, war to peace, hate to love, home to far away, from sane to insane, from a confusion to clarity. Have that contrast and contradiction. Always think in pairs. Always think in binary opposites. You will never go hungry. What is the plot of your favorite film in one sentence? These are the log lines. Write a script on the concept of love is. Show me love. Write a script with the title Video Diary of. These are all very exciting exercises that I would love to drill you with if I had a week in Gabrovci with you. Right, and now we come to my favorite. All of these things don't mean much unless you, as writers, have a way of handling them. The script writing how deals with the properties of your approach, of your idea, of your vision, of your mode, or theme, or genre. Every time you look at a script, pay close attention to the way it deals with its settings. How crucial are these choices for the overall dramatic action? Here are a few proverbs and ideas. Accidents will happen. Extremes meet. It's now or never. Love conquers all. All sins cast long shadows. Pride comes before a fall. There is no such thing as a free lunch. Ladies and gentlemen, here is a dirty secret. All of European literature between 1250 and 1500, all of European literature had one theme. Petrarca, Boccaccio, Shakespeare's sonnets, they all had one basic approach. Everybody wrote along the same basic theme. 250 години. What was that one theme? What was that one approach? Do you want me to tell you in Latin? Do you want me to tell you with the title of an Elvis Presley song? Or do you want me to tell you with a Serbian folk tune? The Serbian folk tune would be the main theme of Shakespearean sonnets is Danas si cvet, sutra uvela ruža. Or today you're a flower and tomorrow you will wilt away. Elvis Presley had a single hit in 1959 called It's Now or Never, Just Do It, Man. Go and make children. That is what Shakespeare's sonnets are about. Or in Latin, the basic organizing idea was carpe diem, seize the day. The organizing idea of rock and roll and punk is just do it, man. Let's go and get drunk tonight. Let's get laid now. There is no tomorrow. That's what happens in times of war. Danger is everywhere. We are only alive now. I grew up on a song by The Who called My Generation, which had a line, I hope I die before I get old. It's an organizing principle when someone says, come on, man, I want to die tonight. And that was the organizing principle of all of love sonnet poetry in Renaissance times. What is the organizing principle of the Nike Corporation? Just do it, man. You can reduce all of the American Constitution to just do it. It's pursuit of happiness. I am a Slav masochist. And I don't want to just do it. I don't want to do it. I'm in complete opposition to the Hollywood. Go and tell Sonia you love her. What's the big deal? No, I want to suffer like a Chekhov character. Because all of 20th century motivations are people who don't quite know what they want to do with themselves. Chekhov, Tarkovsky, Antonioni. I don't like winners. Winners is for losers. I want to lose big time. And that is the beauty of literature as I understand it. Winning is for bankers and it's for clerks, the chinovnitsi, you know? And Leonard Cohen has a book called The Beautiful Losers. I'm a beautiful loser in my taste of literature. There you go. All of the Macedonian, the Bulgarian folk songs are about loss. All of the Irish folk is about loss, man. Let's lose. There you go. So now we are discussing ideas. The how is about ideas. And here we can start quarreling with each other big time. Because there is no hard facts. It's all negotiation of meaning. Meaning is something that you negotiate your audiences to. It's an endless negotiation. Ja mislim da je vaka. The audiences sit there and say, not quite sure. They renegotiate that. We are in an endless negotiation with meaning. Meaning doesn't exist as a fixed property. It has to be renegotiated over and over and over again, repositioned. Every Hamlet can be done billions in billions of different ways, handled in a different property, given different kind of spices, and read in a different way. The dramatic material has no fixed meaning. Any plot, any character, and any dialogue can be turned and tumbled and given different meanings. For example, if I decided to do Hamlet and I asked Woody Allen to be in it, what would you think? I saw you smirk. I saw you just say, ha. What's wrong with Woody Allen? He just wouldn't be is the same language he will be speaking, the same lines, the same soliloquies, the same structure, the same poetry, but Woody Allen, he's going to be funny. Where is meaning? Meaning is in the way in which you decide to handle it. The five basic speeds are tragedy, melodrama, comedy, farce, and tragic comedy. Unfortunately, I wouldn't have much time to talk, but this is my absolutely favorite part of the... But look at this, Little Red Riding Hood, for example. Crvenkapa, kako se vika na bulgarski? Evo je Crvenkapa ovde, but this is a very dark and somber kind of, very gloomy kind of situation. That same meaning can be tweaked. The same story, it's in a melodrama. This little girl is in a black and white world in which she doesn't quite understand where she is. Look at this. This is a Russian socialist realism kind of comedy. This wolf is not really dangerous. Nothing really hurts here. But look, you can tweak it to a farce. Hey, so much fun to be with a wolf, guys. And this is a tragic comedy. This is like a David Lynch film. This grandmother and Little Red Riding Hood are coming out of the stomach of the wolf. Are they eaten? Ova za smenje ili za plaćenje? I don't know. It's like watching a Coen brothers film, you know? You don't know what to make of it. That's the beauty of it. It's sweet and sour and horrid and funny at the same time. Writer's block. I talked about it. I don't know what to write about. I don't know what I'm writing about. Why cooks never get cooking blocks? Simone, tukali si nekade? Keep calm. No, wait, it's a trap. I want to show you a few clips with which I would just illustrate how easy it is to drive meaning in a different way. I love this word, to drive. It's like driving a car. You can drive it in first gear, in second gear, in third gear. You can stall it, or you can go backwards with it. Every film, every story, and every narrative, you can drive in different positions and actually achieve totally different results of meaning. Simon go nema, doj nitko da mi pomogneš ovdje, da ga otvorime DVD, to samo treba.
To vtre.
Idi na DVD. Eto ka. I want to... Daj, počni od Hamlet original. Sakam prvo da bi go... I just want to show you Hamlet's original material. This is Laurence Olivier.
Or not to be.
It's gloomy, it's heavy, it's slow. I'm sorry, this is... There is gravitas about it. We all know this. Let's see what happens. Can you go back now? Let's see what happens when you tweak. Simone, te barav nema, te nemaš. I se ja se snao odjeme tuk. I asked a filmmaker friend of mine to just tweak this same footage of Hamlet a little bit. No, I don't want to go. Yeah, just go to Hamlet tweaked. Look what happens when you just speed it up a bit and add different music. The whole thing tumbles completely.
Or not to be. That is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of...
It's like Woody Allen, I suppose.
Or to take arms against a sea of troubles.
This is not a very good clip. It's not the reproduction. Listen to this jazz music now, suddenly. It looks like it's high on something. Not very good quality. Let's go back. The next thing I did, I asked my friends to take the farcical part of Modern Times by Chaplin. Farce, by definition, depends on speed. It's got to be fast to be funny. When you slow it down, it changes its meaning completely. So there is a little clip from Modern Times in which Charlie Chaplin falls into a machine. Because the music is plinky, plonky, and funny, and because it's speedy, it does not hurt. When you slow it down, you put pain in. If I could teach you one thing about genres and navigation of genres, I would say, if you take the pain out, it's comedy. If you put pain in there, it's melodrama. Such a simple driving exercise. I ask my students, does this hurt? No. Well, go to farce then. If you put the comedy, put the pain in, it becomes static. Can you imagine Tom and Jerry situation in which Tom hits Jerry on the head with a sledgehammer? What usually happens in the films, there is a cut and Jerry is fine again. It doesn't hurt. The children say, "Epane boli, smešno je znači." But imagine a situation in which you slow it down and suddenly Tom is in hospital. He's been in high emergency hospital for 3 months. And Jerry thinks he's a murderer. So he's sitting there, ridden with guilt. And Tom opens his eyes. And Jerry says, "Tom?" And Tom says, "Jerry, is that you?" And Jerry says, "Yes, so you're alive. I forgive you, Jerry." It's bullshit. It becomes a heavy-handed melodrama in which everything hurts. The basic thing about melodrama as a genre is there is lots of pain in it. I mean, tragedy is something different because there is a problem in the split division in the heart of the main character. So let's go to the Modern Times original and then Modern Times tweaked. I'm sorry that the quality of this reproduction... This is the speed.
The sound?
It's okay. Oh, but we're not seeing anything. Sorry. Mi treba pomoć, Simone. Wait a minute. Go nema me ovdje, no. Modern technology. Modern times. Anyway, talking about modern times, Bertolt Brecht ima jedna kusa poema od 4 stihovi. I ta poema vodi ovako. Novite anteni, I have to say this in English. Bertolt Brecht has a short poem, 4 lines poem, says, "The new aerials convey or transmit old lies. The new aerials transmit old lies. And the truth is spoken from one ear to another." What we are after, ladies and gentlemen, is not information. We all have too much information. What we are after is knowledge. And I can see how some of you are going from one place to another, trying to find some knowledge. In an old village, će te vikne neko mitko da imamo. I će ti kaže, I će ti kaže na uvo, Gorane, be careful. And that is the ultimate voice of knowledge, somebody who's been through that. Information is cheap. Knowledge is precious. So what we do in the theater, we're trying to give knowledge to people, small voices. Everyone is so busy under the barrage of too much information of the media, but that's not good enough. We want someone to whisper in our ears. And this is what theater does. It hasn't got the huge ramifications of film, but it's got its very special place. It's somebody. I remember my daughter whispering in my ear. I was sleeping in the afternoon having a siesta, and she whispered in my ear, says, "Daddy, are you going to wake up?" That was the ultimate explosion of sound I've ever had. It was done with very small.
P
pain is back. It's so obvious, with a little tweak, we get a totally different equation of meaning. The last but not least, have you seen a brilliant film about a guy with a writer's block? Probably the best film I've seen about a guy with a writer's block, called Barton Fink. Has anybody seen Barton Fink? Oh, sorry. Hello, hello, hello. I'd like to say thanks on behalf of the group and myself. We hope that we passed the audition. You translate that. Anyway, so I was talking about a film called Barton Fink, probably the best film I have seen about a suffering writer. It's a Coen Brothers film with, John Turturro. I would very much like to ask you to get a DVD of that and show the writer. It's a superb film about a writer who's unable to think or write in Hollywood. And I have a little clip of John Turturro in a completely manic, Kafkaesque kind of stupor, and I will show you the original. And then I will just tweak it a little, and you'll see how the same paranoia of the character can turn into a stupid burlesque like Mr. Bean, just by very minor changes in the approach. Approach is all, ladies and gentlemen. Me ostavi sam bez Simone. So this is John Turturro, suffering. It hurts, everything hurts, it's crazy. The music is ominous, suspicious. And this is peeling off. Bloody Kafkaesque, it's really frightening for me. Look at this. Look at that gooey thing. Ultimate paranoia. Right, so this same scene is completely destroyed with a different kind of renegotiation of meaning just by speeding it up a bit and adding some stupid plinky plonky sounds to it. Doesn't hurt. It's turned into a Mr. Bean little sketch. The meaning is different. Learning how to drive. So can we just go back to the slides for one more time, please? Thank you, Simone. Where would we be without you? Ah, well, I didn't want to go all the way back to the beginning, but, okay. Sorry. You don't want to see them all again, do you? Anyway, where shall we stop? Well, one thing which I know I do well is to show you how very excited I am about these things. And I do it well because I am excited. And that is genuine. That is real. Everything else, you can say this, that, and the other. But the genuine excitement about my vocation and about my stuff is absolutely real. And I thank the powers that be that after all these years of tinkering with this craft, I'm still ever so excited about it. As I said, I am in the middle of a couple of projects. I'm working on Hamlet, which is going to open on the 16th of September in Belgrade with a very fine company there. I'm reworking a production of... can I go online here? Simon, I'd like to go online and just show you my my site for a moment. I'm going to put this little poster. Can you try to see whether we're online at all? Perhaps not. Forget it. Doesn't matter. Simon, are we online here?
Yes.
I just want to go to a site. If you can get me to Google. Well, this is embarrassing. So, is this where I am? I had an opening of a play last week in New Zealand, actually. It's Hotel... How do you work this? I'm a Mac man. I don't understand this PC anymore. So this is the Hotel Europa in New Zealand. I've done all kinds of... What I'm excited about is working in different kind of textures. I've done all kinds of things, from film, television, performance, opera, short films. I'm really excited in different textures. As I mentioned yesterday, I'm interested in the engine that moves things. Whether you use that engine for radio, or you use it for film or television, whether you use the engine to drive a tractor, or a Formula One, it's the same motion, it's the same propulsion, it's the same contrast, contradictions, and opposites working there. It's the same mismatches, it's the same friction, it's the same obratnosti, it's the same naopaku, it's the same friction that produces the dramatic spark. And just to recap, I'm really very excited about trying to figure out an exercise book for script writing, because I'm not interested in formulas, and I'm not interested in recipe books. I'm not interested in pre... there is so much of that. I mean, look at the screenwriting books of Sid Field, for example, you know. But I am interested in trying to figure out how to flex the muscle of exercise, and I'm pretty sure that in the next few weeks you will have lots of opportunities to deal with these various contrasts and contradictions, particularly since you will be taught by different specialists in different areas. You'll be taught by radio specialists as much as by short film specialists, much by performing artists and dance specialists. So what a great opportunity to figure out the different kind of textures and to see how contrasts, contradictions, and opposites can really work in any kind of dimension of the script writing equation that you want to apply it to. And my favorite band is the Beatles, and at the end of the last album of the Beatles, John Lennon says one thing that I use all the time, and Liverpudlian would be, I'd like to say thanks on behalf of the group and myself who helped me pass the audition, which in simple English would be, I would like to say thank you on behalf of the group and myself. I hope that we have passed the audition. Can you imagine Lennon at the end of his Beatles career talking to an audience as if he was a beginner who was passing an audition? So here I am. Thank you for the audition, and I hope that we'll meet again in some other situation, some other format. Thanks very much. So, I don't know whether you want to split. It is now 2 o'clock. Well, 3 minutes to two. So if there is one killer question, give it to me.
Thank you. Have you disagreed with the director who has staged one of your plays?
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Where?
I don't know. I'm asking if you have ever been unsatisfied with...
God, yes.
Really?
Most of the time.
Really?
Yeah. I mean,
and
people...
What do you do?
Well, people just don't read what you think you've wanted to write. When I write a play, I think that I drive the meaning of it in a particular way. I want to give you a very stupid example, but when I was a young man, I wrote a TV play called Tome od benzinskata pumpa, Tom from the petrol station. It's about a simple working man who meets a beautiful woman, and he falls in love with her. She's a teacher of piano, you know, she's an intellectual, and he's a working guy. For the first time in his life, he goes to a record shop and buys a record of Scriabin and puts it on his record player. So I thought that my driving of the script was so simple that in my mind, I knew what the record player that he puts this record on should be. What do you think that record player should be like?
The record player?
Yeah, I mean, turntable that he puts the record on.
Yeah, maybe old.
Well, it must be old. It must be stupid. It must be ridiculous, you know? Mm-hmm. There should be a contrast and contradiction and opposite to the beautiful classical music. I come to the set of the television studio. They've got bloody expensive hi-fi with huge... Jane Petkovsky was the name of the director. He said, what are you doing here? Mm-hmm. And he says to me, do you know how much these guys who work at petrol stations make? Completely beyond the meaning. I said, it's not about how much money they've got. Shall I kill him or kill myself? Or both, you know? So there you go.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry. I would like to make a present to Mr. Stefanovsky, and it's a very special poster of his lecture in Bulgaria, and he looks about 20 years younger.
I've never been, what I would like to ask you, if it's possible, is to get your signatures on the back of the 20 people. Will that be all right? Maybe it'll be worth millions one of these years, I'm pretty sure.
Sure.
And also, you have my email. Please write to me if you want to talk shop and discuss things. Do come here and sign your names, please, if you can be bothered, yeah. Thank you very much. Okay.